tell me about your favorite consciousness theory.
Ah, consciousness. Yeah. And why these are even, related.
Mm-hmm.
Consciousness and free will. I would say do I have a favorite theory? It's just that there are different kinds of theories. I think there are two things. One is explaining the mechanics of how consciousness works in the brain. And I think, why some patterns of brain activity evolving over short bits of time are consistent with that information being accessible to you consciously. I think that some kind of a hybrid between higher order thought theories, global workspace theory, and integrated information theory, I think those each touch on necessary conditions for consciousness in the brain. They each have something to contribute, and I like the idea of a hybrid between those three. But then there's the bigger question of explaining not just the mechanics of how consciousness works in the brain, but trying to get at that hard problem of consciousness. How is it that something that it is built up from matter, can be responsible for a subjective experience, right? For something that it just seems, very mysterious, right? When you think about a conscious sensation, like just seeing a vibrant color or smelling a very pleasant smell, how does that come from workings in the brain? And I think the theory in my mind that I favor now for addressing that is attention schema theory, is Mike Graziano's theory.
Okay, so there are four theories here that have been mentioned: higher order, global, IIT, and attention schema. So the hybrid that you are supposing will be the actual theory is between these four or between the initial three?
So the hybrid that I think will account for just the mechanics of consciousness in the brain are the global workspace theory and higher order thought theory and IIT. Those three might have some things to say about the mechanics in the brain. Attention schema theory is by itself, I think, the answer to the hard problem. And that's where I'm pretty lonely these days in the field. I think there are more and more, there are people who are either coming on board with that kind of a theory or at least being more open to it.
Yeah, I'd like to speak to Michael Graziano on the podcast. I haven't yet.
Oh yeah, he's would be a great person to talk to. Yeah, I quite like his theory. When I first read, sometimes you have an event in life where you never forget it. You never forget where you were and what was going on at the moment that something happened.
Yes,
right. And I was riding on the metro I was riding on the commuter train, I think, near Paris. And I was reading Graziano's 2011 paper where he introduced his theory. And to be honest, I hadn't known about it yet. And I was reading that theory and I was getting most of the way through it. And suddenly it just hit me like a ton of bricks. And I was like, whoa, this is different. His theory is very much in line with Dan Dennett's philosophy. Dan Dennett offered this same kind of idea. He didn't offer a brain mechanism or why this happens. Well, that's sort of what Graziano offered. He said, you can have this idea that the question we need to be asking is, why are we so convinced that there's something else in our brains other than matter? Even though if you go dig around in the brain, there's nothing else in there, just matter. But why are we so convinced that there's something else? Graziano came up with an explanation for why we might come to that conclusion and be really, really vehemently stuck to it. And that, I think that's the beauty of the theory. And so the question is, do I need to explain consciousness? What if I just explain why, or do I need to explain the hard problem? Or is it enough to explain why we are so convinced that there's a hard problem?
Interesting.
Right.
What did that do to your sense of identity?
Not much, really. It didn't really threaten my sense of identity in any way. I think that consciousness is what it is, and what I, you know, the things that I perceive are as real as they ever were and as beautiful as they ever were. It's just that there doesn't have to be, you know, I think that what's implicit in the hard problem in my mind is the idea that there's matter, there are neurons and glia and all what you find in the brain, and then there's consciousness, which is something else. And, you know, attention schema theory, the idea is that the something else just evaporates. It's just, why are we so convinced that there's something else? You know, Graziano has this beautiful story of a neurologist and his patient, and the patient says, you know, there's a squirrel in my head. And this person had sustained brain damage, I think through a stroke. And the neurologist says, well, you mean, you know, you have the thought of a squirrel and you just can't get it out of your head. And the patient says, no. I actually have a furry rodent living inside my cranium, 100%. Like, he's in there. And the neurologist says, well, look, I can show you your brain scan and there's no squirrel in there. And the patient says, well, I know it seems irrational and it doesn't seem like it could be possible. And yet I swear to you 100%, I'm sure of it. There's a squirrel in my cranium. And so, you know, the question is, I always joke about this and when I give talks, is like, well, should I go, if I encountered this patient, should I go and try and get a grant to search for the squirrel? Or should I go and try to get a grant to figure out why this guy is so convinced that there's a squirrel in his head? And the idea is that, well, maybe consciousness is the same, right? Maybe what we really need to understand is why we're so convinced that there's something else in there. When great thinkers going back a very long time have adamantly said, there seems like there is nothing else in there, right? They all come to that, you know, like even if you go back to Leibniz, he has his mill analogy. Like if you could walk into the brain as if it were a mill, you would just see a lot of mechanical things, gears pressing against one another, but nothing that could explain a perception, right? That could explain what it's like to experience the smell of a rose or, you know, et cetera. So I think that, you know, whether you like the theory or not, it sure raises a really good question, right? You know, if I've explained why you're convinced that there's something else, am I done? Do I need to explain anything else?
So where does the what it's like come from?
I mean, for one thing, the phrase what it's like already is interesting and informative, right? It suggests relations. Right? We say what it's like. Well, it's like something else, right? And we know that our perceptual brains and our memories are associative, right? The way we remember things is in relation to other things. So when we say there's something it is like, right? It's saying there's some association, right? And that there's something else that it's not like. So that this particular information, this sensory information that I'm processing now is embedded within a network of associative relations, and it's like something, right? And unlike other things. Now, why is it that, you know, you might say, well, why is it there's something it is like at all in the first place? What attention schema theory says is that information that is modeled by the attention schema is, and this is something that, you know, we don't know the answer to yet, but it proposes that it's sort of flagged in some way so that when asked about it, we can answer the question directly, and we can say things, we can report about it in that way. It's flagged as being different or special, different from information that's encoded outside of your awareness in that moment.
So let's say we can make formal analogies and say that Jupiter is like Neptune because they're both spherical, but they're different in that they're at different radiuses away from the sun or distances away from the sun. But in that they are like scenario, there's nothing about a feeling. Now, there's a feeling of being tormented.
Right.
Okay. So I don't even need to say it's as if or it's like that in that scenario. I could just say I feel that I'm tormented or I feel suffering or what have you. So this feeling.
Pain is often a good example.
Yes, yes, yes. Because it's undeniable. And it's something that can always be turned to the person who is the eliminativist or the person who thinks consciousness is an illusion and say, well, say that to the prisoners of Auschwitz. Like, so explain this feeling. Maybe not the feels like, because the like can be then said it's an analogy, but just the feeling.
Right. And I think that is what philosophers and scientists appeal to when they talk about the hard problem. Right? It's the feeling. It's the what it's like in the first place, like the root level, what it's like. I think, so here's where I'll admit that just I'm a firm believer that it's better to walk around thinking you're ignorant and end up later being right than the opposite. That's to walk around thinking you've got the answer and being wrong. And so here, I don't know. I don't think we know yet. But my hunch is that we can use an explanation or a theory like attention schema theory to get at that question. And that, yes, that explanation will kind of dissolve the question in a way. And one of the nice things about attention schema theory is that it predicts that it predicts why people won't like the theory, because it's just not satisfying, right? It doesn't, that question you just asked, like, you know, if I said, when I'm experiencing pain, it just hurts, right? What is that? How can this possibly account for that? If attention schema theory were to say, well, I can explain all the things that you're saying right now and doing. I'm going to explain all your behaviors right now in terms of brain activity. And you might say, well, yeah, those are just my behaviors. Those are the things I'm saying, but there's this undeniable thing that I'm feeling. Now, if the explanation is complete from an objective point of view, you may still feel dissatisfied with that explanation. Like, well, no, there's something missing, right? So that I think that's one of the things that is neat about the theory is that it predicts that you won't be satisfied with it.
Interesting.
We never will, because we embody, it's the very same brain that is trying to explain the hard problem is the one that's kind of, if you take illusionism to be the right answer, it's the same one that's plagued by it.
There's a concept called coercive theories of meaning. And it's from, I believe it was pioneered by this guy named, or woman, I apologize if I just know the last name, it's Pigeon. I'm not even entirely sure if that's the person who first proposed this. But the idea is that many times in philosophy, when it comes to meaning questions, can dogs fly? You can say, well, that's a meaningful question because we can test it. But then from another point of view, it's unmeaningful because all that is meaningful is are well-formed sentences in a first-order language, and this doesn't fit that, and you would have to predicate over you'd have the scope over something in this real world. Now, few people take that latter theory of meaning, but the point is that there are questions that you can say are meaningful under some theory of meaning, and then you could just say, well, it's unmeaningful, it's nonsense in some other point of view. And so it's often the case that when one takes a certain theory of meaning, many questions you would want to know the meaning of are then called, that's just not meaningful. And then a host of questions that you think should have no meaning all of a sudden do. So for instance, in naive set theory, it's the set of all sets is seen to be paradoxical. And then when you have Z of C, then all of a sudden you have other paradoxes that come in, like the Lohenheim-Skolem paradox, or it's not actually a paradox, but it's just an unintuitive result, or the Banach-Tarski paradox, which is an unintuitive result, not a paradox, that one has to now accept. So it seems like there's always a problem with any given theory of meaning, that from someone else's point of view, it would just be, you're just declaring a certain theory of meaning and then saying that my question lies outside of that, but I could equally take some other theory of meaning and say that your questions lie outside of this. And now we're just fighting over theories of meaning. It's not like we're getting at the question. So sometimes when someone says, we've dissolved the hard problem, to the person who believes there's a hard problem, it seems like you're just dodging the question. And then I'm sure the other person has the other point of view. Like, you're just wrestling with something that's meaningless. You're trying to fight. You're fighting a cloud.
Right. I think that's why they call it the hard problem. But it's hard for a different, in a sense, if seeing it from an illusionist perspective, which is Graziano's theory is in that category. That's the nature of the hard problem. It's not hard. In the, I think philosophically, what would that be? The metaphysical sense is hard in the epistemological sense. It's for us, right? It's a hard problem. So that, let's just say that this theory that's mechanistic is correct and it's accounted for everything, and that you present it with this individual who insists, who like all of us, me included, feels there's meaning here that's not being accounted for. That correct theory is not going to be satisfying to that person. And that may be where it stops, right? That's it. I mean, if we start to agree that that is the right, it's a complete explanation, we're going to be stuck with feeling dissatisfied with it at the same time. And we can't go farther than that. At least could be one way that goes.
Hi, everyone. Hope you're enjoying today's episode. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.